ever bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to
Good morning, and welcome to our worship for Sunday, September 18th. Let us begin with a call to worship. God knows us by name and calls us to follow. The presence of the Lord is with us all the days of our lives. Just as Moses was led by God's goodness, so are we guided. God's ways are sure and lead the faithful to righteousness. Together let us seek God's leading in word and in prayer. Let us worship God. Let us offer the prayers of adoration, thanksgiving, invocation, and confession. Let us pray. Holy God, the mystery of your presence stretches far beyond us. Yet we know you draw near to us, walking beside us in Jesus Christ, guiding us with wisdom by your Holy Spirit, who encourages us as we follow Christ and gives us the strength and wisdom we need to serve you. For all your goodness toward us, O God, we praise and thank you for your provisions, for your protection, for your promises, and for your power given to us to live in this world. Minister to us, we pray, in this time as we worship you. Lift our burdens from us as we lift up our hands and our voices in prayer, praise, and thanksgiving. Grant us your grace, and by the power of your Holy Spirit, make us more perfectly yours. Merciful God, we confess that we need your mercy. We claim to be your people, but we forget to love as you do. We claim to seek your guidance, but we often turn from your ways. We ask for forgiveness, but we fail to forgive others as you forgive us. We claim to listen for your word, but we ignore your wisdom. Forgive us, O God, for our grievous hostility toward you. Amend who we are and direct who you would have us be. For the sake of Jesus Christ, our Lord, in whose glorious and powerful name we pray. Amen. Beloved in the Lord, this is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptance. God is quick to forgive, and God's promise of restoration is for all people. Do not lose heart. Those who humbly confess their sins find favor with God. For God answers prayer and forgives transgressions. Believe this good news. We are forgiven and freed to newness of life. To all who turn to the Lord then, he says, your sins are forgiven. He also says, follow me. Thanks be to God. Let us pray as the Lord Jesus Christ taught his disciples to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We welcome our children this morning, and we trust that you will enjoy what we have in store for you.
Well, welcome back. Let's sing some more songs, okay? Come on, here we go.
Good morning, and welcome to Children's Time. You're probably wondering what I'm doing here. Well, what I have is I have some coins here with me this morning, and I've scotch taped them to a piece of paper, and I'm shading over top of the coins. And by doing that, it brings the impression of the coin or the image of the coin onto the piece of paper like so. And I can see what's on the coin. This is a fun little activity to do. Now, what does coins have to do with our Bible lesson today? Well, let's find out. Has anyone ever asked you a question that there just wasn't any way to answer without getting yourself into trouble? Well, that's what we call a loaded question. A loaded question is one that is worded so that a person cannot answer it without appearing to be guilty. Here are a couple of examples of loaded questions. Have you quit cheating at cards? If you answer yes, well, then you're admitting that you used to cheat. And if you answer no, then you're admitting that you still cheat. How about this question? Do you still pick on your little brother? Well, that is like the other question, isn't it? You're either going to admit that you used to pick on your brother or that you still pick on him. Sometimes a loaded question is asked to try to trick a person into saying something that will get them into trouble. Our Bible lesson today is a good example of that. Jesus was gaining great popularity among the Israelites. This was very upsetting to the religious leaders called Pharisees. They thought he was a threat to their authority. They tried everything they could think of to make Jesus look bad, and yet Jesus had more and more followers every day. So a group of Pharisees met and came up with a plot to trick Jesus into saying something that would discredit him among his followers. The people in Jesus' day were required to pay taxes to the Roman government. That was not very popular with the people. The plan was to go to Jesus and ask him his opinion about paying the taxes. So the Pharisees sent their followers with a few of Herod's followers mixed in and asked Jesus, "Teacher, we know how honest you are. You teach the way of God truthfully. Now, tell us what you think about this. Is it right to pay taxes to Caesar or not?" They were actually trying to trick Jesus because they knew if he said yes, the people would be angry. But if he said no, then he would get into trouble with the Roman authorities. Jesus saw right through their plan, and he did a very wise thing. He asked them for a coin. And he said, "Whose picture is on the coin?" Well, they answered, "It is Caesar." Caesar was the Roman ruler, and all taxes had to be paid to him. Jesus then said to them, "Give to Caesar what belongs to Caesar, and give to God what belongs to God." Now, when you look at coins, our coins here, when you look at them carefully, this is a nickel, you'll see that it says right on it, it says Canada. It doesn't. So I suppose you could say that our coins belong to Canada, doesn't it? Or the government of Canada. What about God? Jesus also said, "Give to God what belongs to God." The Bible says that we were created by God and that we were created in the image of God. If we are created by God and we were created in His image, then we must belong to Him. That means we must give ourselves to Him. Let's take a moment and pray. Dear God, help us give you what is yours. Help us to spend our hours in acts of love and our days in doing acts of kindness. May we always obey you and give you honor. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So I hope this week you'll take a few coins, take them to a piece of paper like this, and have some fun coloring their images. And it'll remind you of our story today. Have a great week.
Let us offer up a prayer of understanding. Let us pray. God of wisdom, as we turn to the scriptures, May we hear your voice calling us to deeper faith in you and truer devotion to you. Through Jesus Christ, your living word, in whose glorious and powerful name we pray. Amen. Today's scripture reading comes to us from the Gospel of St. Matthew, chapter 22, reading from verse 15 through to verse 22. Then the Pharisees went and plotted to entrap him in what he said. So they sent their disciples to him, along with the Herodians, saying, "Teacher, we know that you are sincere and teach the way of God in accordance with truth, and show a difference to no one, for you do not regard people with partiality. Tell us, then, what you think. Is it lawful to pay taxes to the emperor or not?" But Jesus, aware of their malice, said, "Why are you putting me to the test, you hypocrites? Show me the coin for the tax." And they brought him a denarius. Then he said to them, "Whose head is this, and whose title?" They answered, "The emperor's." Then he said to them, "Give therefore to the emperor the things that are the emperor's, and to God the things that are God's." When they heard this, they were amazed, and they left him and went away. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Bow your heads at me, my friends, and let us pray. God, we give you thanks for your word, which is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. We pray that you will bless your word into our hearts and glorify your name. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts together be acceptable in your sight, O God, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Today, my friends, I wish to speak with you on the topic, doing what is right. And I will focus on the passage which was read from Matthew's Gospel, chapter 22, reading from verse 15 through to 22. And like I did last week, again, I wish to start today's message with a story that has nothing to do with the passage from which I will preach, and nothing to do with what I will be talking about. To be clear, the story is about some church folks who were caught in a lie, and the passage from which I will preach is about the disciples of the Pharisees being caught in their own deceit. Once again, you will have to choose. And the story goes like this. A minister told his congregation, "Next week, I plan to preach about the sin of lying. To help you understand my sermon, I want you all to read the Gospel of Mark, chapter 17. The following Sunday, as he prepared to deliver his sermon, the minister asked for a show of hands. He wanted to know how many had read Mark's Gospel, chapter 17. Every hand went up. The minister smiled and said, "Mark has only 16 chapters. I will now proceed with my sermon on the sin of lying." Over the last few weeks, we have followed the progression of the buildup of tension between Jesus and the religious leaders of Israel. In today's scripture text, we see the controversy heightening as the Pharisees ratchet up their nefarious plan to get rid of Jesus. The disciples of the Pharisees and the Herodians approached Jesus to ask him a trick question. They received an unexpected answer that effectively thwarted their plans, at least for the moment. Once again, the Pharisees fell into their own trap, which they had set for Jesus. by readily producing from their persons a coin with Caesar's image and inscription. They self-identified and self-incriminated themselves as being actively part of Caesar Augustus's pagan Rome religion. Let me explain. Tiberius Caesar Augustus, emperor of Rome at the time of Jesus's tense encounter with the Pharisees, had his image etched on a coin along with his inscription of his name and title. Being under Roman rule, Israel was required to pay a census tax, what was otherwise called a headcount tax, to Caesar. And they could only pay this tax by using Caesar's Roman coin, a denarius. The coin enshrined Caesar as divine lord over the Roman Empire under which Israel fell. Caesar wasn't just the secular head of state. He was proclaimed, certainly self-proclaimed, to be a god. The Caesar was worshipped with full religious honors, recounted Morley. In principle, Israel actively resisted paying census tax because they regarded Roman rule as tyrannical, and living under the rule of a self-enshrined god and having to bear a graven image of an idol violated their religion. In Israel's view, to live under the rule of Tiberius Caesar was to be in direct conflict with the Torah, which contained the laws of God. Furthermore, Caesar's demand to be worshipped and served by the subjects of his kingdom restricted Israel's freedom to exercise their own religion. To begin with, worship of Caesar violated the first two commandments given to Moses for Israel by God. And these two commandments state, "You shall have no other God before me. You shall not make for yourself any image in the form of anything in heaven, above, or on the earth beneath, or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God." Exodus chapter 20, verses 3 to 5. The people of Israel paid the tax simply for their safety and quasi-freedom, but not as a tribute to Caesar, which was what paying taxes with Caesar's coin represented. To practice Judaism, which was the Jewish faith, meant devoutly observing the Torah. The preeminent and central doctrine of Judaism was monotheism, which means there is only one God. According to the Jewish faith, a graven image of any being which is enshrined as a divine deity amounted to idolatry and a violation of the first two commandments. Having therefore provided this background, the consideration that seems to arise from the text is a twofold one of responsibility and loyalty. First, there is a difficult responsibility that the disciples of Jesus must bear. On the surface of the account in today's text, Jesus appears to take no issue with paying taxes to Caesar. Neither does he appear to take any issue with paying the temple tax, which was for the upkeep of the temple. In Matthew's Gospel, chapter 17, verses 24 through to 27, Jesus suggested that it was better to pay taxes than not to do so for the sake of preserving community good relations, Though Jews resisted the idea of paying taxes to Caesar, in Matthew's Gospel chapter 17, we get a glimpse into Jesus' mindset on paying taxes. He instructed Peter to go to the seaside, and in the mouth of the first fish that he caught, he would find a 4-drachma coin, which he should take and pay the temple tax owed for Peter and Jesus himself, so that, in the words of Jesus, they may not cause an offense. A part of doing what is right, which is today's topic, is to be able to recognize our responsibility to the community to which we belong. In respect of the text that we read today, it is not an economic responsibility that it seems we are called to bear, but a social responsibility. I remember when I was pursuing an MBA a few years ago, a concept that was very eminent was one that was called corporate social responsibility. The idea of corporate social responsibility is that companies or organizations have an ethical and moral duty to be good citizens. A company or an organization that is a good citizen is considered to be one which contributes to the sustainability and the development of the community in which it operates and to which it is socially accountable. In a similar sense, the same kind of social contract exists or ought to exist between every citizen and the community to which he or she belongs. We have an ethical and a moral duty to be good citizens who work for and act in ways that support the sustainability and the development of the communities to which we belong. To be clear, Jesus promoted this kind of responsibility all throughout the Gospels. It is not an easy responsibility, but we must do everything within our powers to preserve community health and well-being. Though we may not agree with the policies of policymakers or those who implement and enforce policy, Jesus expects of us who are his disciples to practice responsible citizenship. If I may pivot to the wording of today's message title, to do what is right is to know and to live out the knowledge that being good citizens honors God, who expects it of us. The Bible is replete with references of God calling his people to be good citizens. Half of the Ten Commandments in Exodus chapter 20 is about being good citizens. We cannot serve God well, please him, and glorify his name if we fail to be good citizens. Being a good citizen is a difficult responsibility because it challenges us to resist our base impulses and passions and make personal sacrifices. But whoever said serving God is easy? Doing what is right is never easy. If it were, then the church would be filled to overflowing with righteous people today. It is a challenge for us, my friends, for we have this very difficult responsibility of maintaining a balance in this world of which we are a part. We are challenged by the Word of God to live as responsible, good citizens in our communities. And that means that we must resist every urge to live for ourselves only and to think about our own interests only. That means we must extend ourselves to whatever it calls for to ensure the health and the well-being of our communities. But not only do we have a difficult responsibility, as the text points us to consider, but the text also points us to consider that the disciples of Jesus must have undivided loyalty. Here now we come to the crux of the matter in the text. Jesus' response to the Pharisees was essentially a challenge to examine where their loyalties lie. To do this, Jesus asked them for one of the coins used to pay taxes to Caesar. He lifted up the coin in full view of all who could see it, and then used the coin to expose their hypocrisy of bearing a graven image of a self-enshrined god while claiming to be in the service of the living God. Jesus' response to the Pharisees highlighted the choice that they had made. The Pharisees must choose between their idolatrous deifying of Caesar and serving and worshiping the true and living God. If we should apply the intent of today's text to the church, Jesus challenges the loyalties of all his disciples. We must examine ourselves to see where our loyalties lie, and we must never conflate our loyalty to God with our responsibility to this world. Matthew is clear that loyalty to God is a different and higher category than loyalty to Caesar. Though we have responsibilities in our communities, we must never cause our responsibilities to define our loyalty to God. In fact, it should be the other way around, where our loyalty to God shapes our understanding of our responsibilities in our communities. Jesus challenges us, therefore, to choose between what loyalty to God represents and what loyalty to Caesar represents. Caesar is a picture of idolatry and sin. And if as disciples of Jesus Christ, we give over and beyond our responsibility to the cause of Caesar than we do to the cause of God, according to the text, Jesus asserts that it is clear where our loyalties lie, divided between God and Caesar. But to do what is right, my friends, is to live righteously in the sight of God, in spite of our responsibility to Caesar or to the world in which we live. The righteousness of God demands it. The righteousness of God demands that we recognize that all that we are and all that we possess are but gifts from God and belong to God. The disciples of Jesus Christ, who embody undivided loyalty to God, have their priorities in perfect order. Undivided loyalty to God means that no one else and nothing else can compete for the love that we have for God. When we are loyal to God, we cling to God by loving Him with all our hearts, all our minds, all our souls, and all our strengths. According to Matthew 22:37, Mark 12:30, and Deuteronomy 6, verse 5. For the true disciple of Jesus Christ understands that though we carry out our responsibilities to our communities in this world. We do so by serving God wholeheartedly. The disciples of Jesus Christ know the first two commandments well, and also know that God will not share his throne or the throne of our hearts with anyone or anything else. But how can we be loyal to God if we do not know what God expects and requires of us? And how can we know what God expects and requires of us if we do not know the scriptures that lay out the expectations and requirements of God? And how can we know the scriptures except that we study them devoutly? And how can we prove the requirements of scripture to be of God except that we put them to the test by practicing them? We practice loyalty to God in good times and bad times, without condition, costing us what it may. We practice loyalty to God when we obey and live out God's word and hold on to God and his word, even when it is difficult and irrational and does not satisfy our flesh. We practice loyalty to God when we give God the first place in our lives, in our affections, and in our devotions, while giving our hearts to God as holy ground. This is what it means to give to God the things that belong to God, according to Matthew 22, verse 21. Doing the right thing means not giving in to sin by pretending before others like the Pharisees did, or thinking that we can trick God into believing that he is first in our lives, or that our lives are lived to do his bidding. Just like the congregation in the story I told at the beginning of this message was exposed in the sin of lying before their pastor and before God, all of our lives, the good, the bad, and the ugly, laid bare before God, and will be exposed when we are called to give an account before Christ, the eternal judge. Jesus tells us in today's passage that in this world, as disciples, we have a difficult responsibility. But we must never fail to be good citizens. Not only do we have a difficult responsibility in this world, but the text also challenges us to embody and to exercise undivided loyalty to God. For God will not share his glory, his throne, or the throne of our hearts with anyone or anything else. In the name of God who is Father, God who is Son, and God who is Spirit. Amen. Let us offer up the prayer of intercession and supplication. Let us pray. Benevolent God, we are grateful for your steadfast love amid so much that has changed over the last year. But still, we face more unpredictable possibilities as the pandemic rages on. We pray that you may draw close to any who finds the uncertainty unsettling, and help us remain connected to you and to each other. Heal the world of this terrible plague, whether by therapeutics, vaccines, or a mighty miraculous touch by your strong right hand. In a time when so many have lost their jobs and others have had their livelihoods threatened, we pray that you will give encouragement to all. Help us to be good neighbors to one another and kind to all we meet along the way. We pray for all those who are struggling in this time, in this country, on this continent, and across the world. We commend to you those facing illness or waiting for treatment, those who have lost income and worry about coming expenses, and shelter where there is winter. Those who are grieving the loss of someone close, and those whose mental health is under pressure and has become frayed in these times. Awaken your people around the world to attend to the needs of those at risk in our communities, so that they will know your comfort, compassion, and care. It is through your Son, Jesus Christ, in whose glorious and powerful name we pray for all these things, trusting and believing in you to hear and answer in your mercy and grace for the sake of the world you love. Amen. Jesus reminds us to give to God the things that are God's. Our God has been beyond generous to us, so now we simply return the tithes that are offering to God. As we dedicate the tithes and offerings for this week, freely, willingly, and cheerfully, we do so with the knowledge that we have been blessed and sustained by the Lord, and everything we have has been given to us by God. For this reason, we have purposed in our hearts to give back to God an offering of praise, thanksgiving, and joy. Let us pray. God of abundance, we pray that even as we bring what we have to share, the fruit of your blessings, and the portion of your goodness to us, we pray that you bless them. Bless our gifts and our lives, so that compassion and generosity will join hands and your mission in the world fulfilled. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Our closing song for today, Take My Life and Let It Be. Please receive the benediction. Now may our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God our Father, who loved us through grace, gave us eternal comfort and good hope. Comfort your hearts and strengthen them in every good work and word. God be with you, my friends. Amen.
All the saints and angels, they bow before your throne. All the elders cast their crowns before the Lamb of God and sing, "You worthy of it all. From you are all things, and to you are all things. You deserve the glory. Singing, oh, oh, oh.
Thank you.
waters afar to the fragrance of spring. Every creature unique in the song that it sings, all its claiming. Indescribable, uncontainable, you place the stars in the sky and you know them by. But where it should go, or seen heavenly storehouses laden with snow, who imagined the sun and gives source to its light, yet conceals it to bring us the coolness of night. None can fathom.
Praise will rise to Christ our King.
that held us now gives way to Him who is our peace. His final breath upon the cross is now alive in me. Your name.
Our God